They're losing the fight for another day. The life that she's known is falling apart. A fatherless home, a child's broken heart. You're holding her hand, you're straining for words, you're trying to make sense of it all. She's desperate for hope, darkness clouding her view. She's looking to you. Just love her like Jesus. Carry.
My soul, Holy Spirit, take control. today as she slips in, trying to fade into the faces. The girl's teasing laughter is carrying farther than they know, farther than they know. But if we are the body, why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And if we are the body, why aren't his feet going? Why is his love not showing? Then there is a way. There is a way. Traveler is far away from home. He sheds his coat and quietly sinks into the back row. The weight of their judgmental glances tells him that his chances are better out on the road. We are the body. Why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And if we are the body, why aren't his feet going? Why is his love not showing? Choose who should come, and we are the body of Christ. If we are the body, why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And if we are the body, why aren't his feet going? Why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And if we are the body, why aren't his feet going? Why is his love not showing? Then there is a way. Jesus is the way. We were made to be courageous. We were made to lead the way. We could be the generation that finally breaks the chains. We were made to be courageous. We were made to be courageous. We were warriors on the front lines, standing unafraid. But now we're watchers on the sidelines while our families slip away. Where are you, men of courage? You were made for so much more. Let the pounding of our hearts cry, we will serve the Lord. We were made to be courageous, and we're taking back the fight. We were made to be courageous, and it starts with us tonight. The only way we'll ever stand is on our knees with lifted hands. Make us courageous. Lord, make us courageous. This
to the call. We will love our wives and children. We refuse to let them fall. We will reignite the passion that we bury deep inside. May the watchers become warriors. Let the men of God arise. We will make them be courageous and we'll take it back the fight. We will make them be courageous and it starts with us tonight.
Good morning, church! Man, it is so great to see you guys here. I know that we are not allowed to get up and shake hands and give hugs and give greetings, but why don't you look to the person to your right or the person to your left and just give them a great big good morning. Give them a wave. I don't know. Yeah. Well, we are here. And we are gathered today, even though it is a wet and rainy Sunday, and we are going to worship our Lord. But before we do that, we're going to have a call to worship on the video by Dan Vivona. So please join me in watching this.
Have mercy on me, O God, have mercy on me, for in you my soul takes refuge. I will take refuge in the shadow of your wings until the disaster has passed. I cry out to God Most High, to God who fulfills his purpose for me. He sends from heaven and saves me. Rebuking those who hotly pursue me, God sends his love and his faithfulness. I am in the midst of lions. I lie among ravenous beasts. Men whose teeth are spears and arrows, whose tongues are sharp swords. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. They spread a net for my feet. I was bowed down in distress. They dug a pit in my path, but they have fallen into it themselves. My heart is steadfast, O God, my heart is steadfast. I will sing and make music. Awake, my soul. Awake, harp and lyre. I will awaken the dawn. I will praise you, O Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples. For great is your love, reaching to the heavens. For your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth.
Hey, if you guys want to stand up, we're going to sing some songs. Thank you.
is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Let's sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings that chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of love.
Thank you. turn bows into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one.
Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, God, there is nothing better than you. Lord, we believe that and we mean that, Lord. We've searched the world and we couldn't find anything that could ever satisfy our souls better than you, Lord. And so, Lord, we just come before you today on this rainy day and we just lift up our voices to you. We lift up our prayers to you. Lord, we thank you for being a God who hears our prayers, for being a God who sees us where we're at. God, you know the valleys that some of us are in, Lord. You know the mountain peaks that others are in, Lord. And you know where all of us are. You know our thoughts. You know where we are, what burdens, what emotions we are carrying. And so, Lord, we just simply bring ourselves to you, Lord. And we cry out today on this Palm Sunday morning. We say, Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are God. And you are worthy to be praised. Lord, we thank you for the joy that we have today because of you. We praise you for turning our ashes, God, into some beauty, Lord. We thank you for what you end up doing on the cross. And Lord, as we reflect on this morning, as you have come in riding on the donkey, and as you are lifted up and you are declared as King and Lord over all, God, we just are reminded that even though this week is really hard, it's really dark, we realize the price that was paid for all of us, God. We realize that, Lord, you cannot be contained. And Lord, we're excited to worship next Sunday and to celebrate you being risen. But Lord, we want to just reflect, God, on all that you've done for us on that cross. Lord, thank you for the price that you went through for us and for our sin, God. Something that we could never do for ourselves. And so, God, we just cry out to you. We open up our hearts. We open up our minds. We give you ourselves today, wherever we are, whether we're at home or whether we're here at Hagerstown Church of Nazareth. God, we just give you ourselves. We look to you, and we ask that you would just work through your Holy Spirit and that you would speak to our very hearts today. God, we pray that you would just anoint this message that Pastor Steve is going to come give us today. And we just pray that you would just help us to have new ears and new eyes to hear and to see what you would have for us today. And Lord, that we would put it into practice. Lord, that we would go and we would declare you Lord and Savior of our lives everywhere that we go. Lord, make us more like you today and strengthen us, God, where we are weak. And comfort those who are mourning today, oh God. I pray that you would just bless and you would encourage us, Lord, and you just rain down on us your spirit, Lord. We are yours and we are here for you. So, Lord, have your way. We love you, Jesus. It's in your name that we pray.
Amen. So, can we give the worship team just a thank you? Yeah, that was remarkable. Well, I have a couple of announcements. This Thursday is April 1st, and it is our Tenebrae service. It's the Maundy-Thursday service. That is going to be at 7 p.m. Whether you want to join us through Facebook Live or our Church Live app, or in person. There's so many options for you to just get connected and to be here. And then the second announcement is our Easter Sunday celebration is literally next Sunday, April 4th. And if you are a child, can you give me a big wave? No? Oh, great, great. I love to see it. We love kids, right? And guess what? Kids Church is coming back on Easter Sunday. Yes, let's praise. Yes. Our kids need to be in church, and they have done a fabulous job worshiping with us. But sometimes the sermon gets a little lost on their ears, and so we are so glad to have a service dedicated wholly to them in their language where they can praise Jesus, learn about him, and learn about what he does for us. And so if you are a child, there will be Children's Church at the 9:30 service next Sunday. However, the 11 o'clock service, there will be no Children's Church. So there's the separation there. And then if you are joining us live next week, if you're at home, the live stream service is going to be at 9:30 a.m. So that's going to be the same as it has been for however many weeks we've been doing this time. So if you would, we're going to have Steve come up, and he is going to give us the scripture reading for today.
You know, now that we've had our shots, Linda and I, and we've gone through our two-week period, we're back. And it's great. And the anticipation we had to come back, we need to have that same anticipation for Jesus. If you want to follow along, the scripture reading today is from Mark chapter 11, starting with verse 1. And though it might be a familiar story, it helps us focus on today and this coming week. It's a wonderful time, with a tragic story and a wonderful ending. This is entitled, Jesus Comes to Jerusalem as King. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks, why are you doing this? Say, the Lord needs it, and we'll send it back here shortly. They went, and they found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, what are you doing untying that colt? They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven. Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went to Bethany with the 12. To God be the glory.
Well, happy Palm Sunday to everybody. It's good to see you here. This morning we want to think together about Palm Sunday as we enter into Holy Week. And I just wanted to say it's good to see some of you coming back. I know Steve and Linda have been back a couple weeks, and so some of you are getting your shots and finally feel comfortable in coming out. So welcome. It's just glad to little by little kind of be back together. So thinking about Palm Sunday, actually the message this morning is built around two questions. So it's simple, not 3 points, but two questions, okay, is where we're going today. And so the first question is, which parade are you following? Which parade are you following? So it's kind of amazing that Jesus decided to begin the last week of his life with a parade. That's really what it was. Actually, there were two parades. We'll get to the second parade in just a minute, one that we won't usually talk about. But I was thinking about parades, and I love a parade. I remember it was actually back in 2002, around Labor Day, that Pam and I moved to Hagerstown. And we pulled in, and we lived in the house, the White House across the street, where Pastor Kevin and Ashley now across the parking lot, not the street. So we moved in there with our three kids back in 2002, around Labor Day. So it was like the middle of October, like a month or so later, that I started hearing about this parade in Hagerstown. But you know what I'm talking about, right? So I heard that Hagerstown had this thing, and people asked, Pastor, are you going to the Mummers Parade? And I said, what? The Mummers Parade. And I didn't know what a mummer was. Some of you know what a mummer is. I had to Google it, okay? So a mummer is a person that dresses up in a costume. So, okay, so this is a parade, I thought, where people dress up in their Halloween costumes. It was around Halloween time, and they walk down the street in their Halloween costumes. I thought, that's kind of a strange parade. But then people start saying to me, well, you know, so-and-so is playing in the high school band, and we're having this float in the parade. And so I figured a lot bigger than just people marching down the street in costumes. So I learned that this parade is at nighttime, and that it's actually one of the largest parades on the East Coast. So Pam and I decided to go check it out. And one of our friends in church said, oh, my mom lives right on South Potomac Street, and you can just sit on the porch, and she has hot chocolate and snacks. And we said, we'll be there, you know? So we showed up, and it was a great place to kind of watch the parade. And I found out the Mummers Parade, it's like this big celebration in our community. There's bands and floats and city and county dignitaries and fancy cars, and there's a king and queen and fire trucks and all the things, and of course, I don't know, Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, and of course, the mummers. Some people were in costumes. What I didn't expect was that halfway through the parade, it started snowing. It was freezing cold. Well, so we don't go every year to the Mummers Parade, but I've been back several times, and an especially memorable one was when our grandson was in the Funkstown Cub Scouts. And his troop was going to ride on a float or trailer through the parade. So we sat for 2 hours waiting to see our grandson in his uniform. My son-in-law is from Haiti, and he's sitting there freezing. And he says, I just don't understand this. Why do Americans do this? You know, We're sitting here freezing, and we said, it's a parade, Sadrach, it's a parade. It's what we do to celebrate in America. And he just shook his head and shivered and wrapped the blanket around him. Well, if the first Sunday was a parade, it was a festive parade, Palm Sunday. And there were shouts of joy and hope and people waving branches, we know, and shouting their praises to Jesus. But I want to talk about a second parade that we don't talk about, but it happened. So every year, so it's Passover time, okay? So do you remember what Passover was? Well, Passover, of course, was the celebration of how the angel of death passed over Egypt and worked through Moses to set free the people of Israel from slavery in Egypt. So it was a celebration of victory over the Egyptian Empire, God's victory over the empire. So the Romans knew what this Passover celebration was all about. And so the Roman governor of Judea would be sure that at Passover time, he was in Jerusalem so that the citizens didn't get any big ideas about, well, an empire on Passover was defeated, and he wanted to remind the Israelites that who was the boss? The Roman Empire was the boss. So a lot of the time, Pilate, who we'll talk more about later in the week, spent his time in his beautiful new palace on the Mediterranean coast where there are cool breezes, but he wanted to make sure that he was in Jerusalem on the Passover. So the second parade, we don't know if it happened the same time, but it would have been around the same time. It would have been early in the Passover week. It was Pilate and his army going through the main entrance to the city of Jerusalem with banners and soldiers and cavalry and troops marching behind him. And the streets would have been cleared and large crowds would have been on display to watch the magnificent Roman armies make their way into the holy city of Jerusalem. And the Israelites could not miss the point that parade made. But they were able to celebrate Passover only because Rome was generous enough to allow them. And they were also conveying the message, no protests, no riots. We want a peaceful celebration. So there's this huge marching in, horses, cavalry, banners. There's one parade. And then on the other side of town, there's kind of this ragtag procession of peasants. And Jesus riding not a beautiful stallion, but a colt, a donkey, down the Mount of Olives, through the east side of the city, the small entrance, out-of-the-way entrance into the city. And it wasn't banners and swords, but cloaks and palm branches that they were waving. There were small children being lifted up on their shoulders so that they could see Jesus going by, but they were shouting, Hosanna. And really, the next part of what they shouted, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, it was treason. These were uprising kinds of words. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Those were treasonous words that some other king would now be coming to take his place. So Pilate rode in on his war horse through the largest gate of the city, decked out in armor, banners waving, troops marching, Jesus almost the opposite on a donkey colt, no armor, followed by children waving branches. Two parades. They couldn't have been more different. One, a military display of imperial might, and the other, a small protest. A poor band of peasants crying Hosanna. You know what Hosanna means, right? It literally means save us. Save us now. It's not a simple cheer. It's a prayer. It's a plea. It paves the way for what's going to happen later in the week. Jesus, save us. Save us now. So there's this day of contrast, and back to our question, which parade will you follow? The Jesus Kingdom of God parade or Pilate's parade, the Kingdom of Caesar? Two contrasts are really central to our understanding of the gospel. These Bible scholars, Marcus Borg and Dominic Cresson, say the confrontation between these two kingdoms continues for the last week of Jesus' life. As we all know, this week will end with Jesus' execution by the powers who ruled his world. Holy Week is the story of this confrontation. Palm Sunday is the beginning. Two parades. So, as those who seek to be faithful to Jesus, we are forced to ask ourselves, which parade are we a part of as we move through the week? We should all try to commit ourselves to joining Jesus' parade, to join the band of followers waving their palms and their pleas and their prayers. But as we step back and look at Jesus' parade, we realize it's not the easy road, is it? Because if we follow the Jesus parade, we know that means sometimes we join him in the upper room, where he talks about betrayal and denial. And he stoops down and washes his disciples' feet and says, "My kingdom is about humbly serving each other." This is the Jesus parade. We'll watch as he, there in the upper room, we'll do this on Thursday night. Hope you can come join us. He breaks bread. He pours out a cup. And he says, "These remind you of my broken body and my shed blood." His suffering love. If we follow Jesus, it will take us to a garden, right? Where he cries out to God, "If there's any other way, let this cup be passed from me." He prays and pleads for his life, and his followers can't even stay awake and pray with him for just a little while. We'll watch as Jesus is led away, and he's betrayed and arrested. And if we continue to follow Jesus, we'll encounter that time when the cries of Hosanna turn into cries of what? Crucify him, crucify him. And finally, we'll watch as he gives his life on the cross. This is the way of Jesus. This is what it means to follow and live in his kingdom. And it's not an easy parade to join in. If we follow Jesus through the end of the week, we'll also have to be honest and realize that sometimes we've chosen the wrong parade. We may have turned away from him. The path has become too difficult or discouraged, or we've chosen the wrong thing. But we know he is gracious and forgiving. So, on this Palm Sunday, at this moment, we're poised with palm branches and shouts of Hosanna, and we're asked to choose. Will we choose to follow Jesus? It's a very different parade than the parade much of the world is following. We continue along this parade route as it leads to betrayal and suffering and death. But we align ourselves with this God whose power is made perfect not in military might but in the vulnerability of love, who comes on the back of a donkey. Whose greatest victory isn't found on a battlefield but in an empty tomb. We choose again to follow Jesus. Like the first followers of Jesus, we don't know what this discipleship will mean for us. We don't know where the path of being a disciple, following Jesus, will lead us. And perhaps sometimes it seems too hard. It's been pretty hard lately, hasn't it? Sometimes we felt beaten down by this strange year when parades have been canceled. And celebrations that we've always cherished can't happen. And we sometimes felt overwhelmed, haven't we? When the ongoing news of sickness and suffering, we've realized how fragile things can be. Whoever dreamed that we'd be here a year later? It's tempting, isn't it, to just kind of skip from Palm Sunday and go to Easter. Because those are the celebrations that we like. But did you know that the way to Easter is always the way of the cross, right? You can't skip the cross. You can't gloss over that life has its times of suffering and struggle and difficulty. But Palm Sunday also reminds us that though sometimes we feel some element of the despair of the cross, the hope of Easter is always there, right? Always there. And the one who leads us onward, this strange parade, and we cry out to him, and he travels before us. We know Jesus is ahead of us, and he bore the cross, and he helps us to bear our cross. And so we cry out to him, Hosanna, Lord, save us. Lord, help us. We need you in these moments of uncertainty and times of trial. And so we pick up our cloaks, and we pick up our branches, and we make our way behind Jesus as he marches toward the cross, knowing that he's already traveled the road before us and he knows how to lead us as we move from pain to praise, from suffering to salvation, and finally from death to resurrection. So, that's the first question. Which parade are you following? Are you following Jesus? Are you in the Jesus parade? Are you willing to serve and to suffer and to sometimes struggle in following him? Now, this morning we're going to, we did this some times past, but we're going to take a little break, okay, because then we're going to go to question number two. You obviously see it up there. How do we live? So I'm going to ask you to stand up. Okay? I got a request on this. So actually, let's just kind of the real branches, but so let's just kind of, if you turn around and right, if you look at the TV up there, that's where the camera is. And somebody was telling me, you know, we can't see who's there. So just kind of like wave your branch there, okay? And we hope, hello. Are you getting us, Tim? There, yeah, hey, it's coming around. You can see if it's pointing to you. Hi, everybody at home. Happy Palm Sunday, right? Okay, all right. You can stretch if you want. You can do whatever you want. Yeah, okay. All right. All right, have a seat. Good. All right, so Palm Sunday. Question number one was, which parade are you following? Are you following your Savior today? Are you seeking every day when you get up to live in the way of Jesus, serving, sacrificial love, giving your life to him? We don't do that perfectly, but that's our heart, to follow and serve Jesus. Okay, so if we decide to follow and jump into this parade, this scraggly peasant parade of Jesus, now what do we do? How do we live? Another fascinating aspect of the Palm Sunday account here, especially in the book of Mark, he spends half of the story, six verses, talking about how they were going to get the donkey. Six verses. It's like half the story. Jesus had apparently prearranged this. It was all set up with this guy. He told them what to tell him, and you know, why are you taking the donkey? And, you know, well, the Lord needs it. And, you know, six verses explaining all that stuff. So, I don't know. You know, these prearrangements on the donkey, the colt, that's a baby donkey, right? Had never been ridden. It's kind of an interesting twist in the story. So his two disciples are given this task of making the transportation arrangements for Jesus. Now, if we go back to the beginning of Mark's gospel, we find John the Baptist, and he's preaching, and he's shouting out in the wilderness, "Prepare for the coming of the Lord." Well, that preparation then finds its fulfillment on Palm Sunday, because now the Lord Jesus is coming to establish his kingdom through the cross. He's going to make his entrance. But he needs transportation, and not just any transportation. In fact, this is all carefully planned out, because Jesus here is very meticulously fulfilling the prophecy of Zechariah, written 500 years before the birth of Jesus. Amazing. So here's what the prophet Zechariah wrote 500 years before Jesus. "Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion." Zion's another word for Jerusalem. "Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Amazing. 500 years before Christ is born. So Jesus is doing this in order to be sure that the prophecy is fulfilled. He set it all up. He's got it all orchestrated. Now, we don't know which of the two disciples that Jesus chose. It could have been any of the 12 guys. But I'm pretty sure, if I were going to make a wager on this, I'm pretty sure, which I wouldn't do, I'm pretty sure he chose James and John, because they were the ones, the chapter before, that were arguing about who's going to be the greatest in Jesus' kingdom. When they finally get to Jerusalem, who will be appointed to his top cabinet posts? Who's going to sit on the right and left hand of Jesus? Who's going to have the best offices in Jesus' White House? So what that tells me about James and John is they may have been following Jesus' parade, but in their hearts, they were still attending Pilate's parade. They had visions of war horses and weapons and violent overthrow of Rome, which was true of all of Jesus' disciples. They were all in on this argument. Who's going to be the greatest? Jesus carrying this heavy load of the cross, and they're arguing about position and power and place. Shows how easily we can get distracted. Doesn't it seem likely to you that Jesus would call on James and John and say, "Hey, you guys, you two guys, come over here. I got an important job for you." He may have kind of got a gleam in his eye and a little smirk on his face. "Got a special job for you." And maybe they're thinking, "Great, maybe I'll be Jesus' vice president. Or I'm hoping for secretary of state in Jesus' kingdom." He said, "James, John, come over here. I need you to go get me a donkey. This is really important, guys. I'm assigning two of you. Fetch me a donkey." James, John, I'm kind of making this up. I got to tell you, I'm kind of reading between the lines, but it's not too far-fetched. What are their reactions? These guys, the disciples all, they wanted to have the top position. What? Get the donkey? We were thinking something like really important, like, I don't know, maybe recruit your army, or, I mean, we could handle that. We could raise an army up for you, Jesus. I know a lot of people. Nope. Go get my donkey. And James and John, they're going to this little town on the outskirts of Jerusalem, away from the crowds. And they find this baby donkey that's never been ridden. And I can't imagine, can't you? Like, James is like pulling on the guide rope. And John is kind of like on the back end, kind of putting his shoulder into the donkey butt. Push that baby. Get him moving. We got to take him to Jesus. That's our job. Well, they finally got the donkey to Jesus, and they took off their cloaks and laid him on the back of the donkey for Jesus to sit on. I kind of wonder, do you know what happens when somebody sits on a donkey that's never been ridden? I don't know. Maybe Jesus, like, he probably did have, like, this special way with animals, but we don't know. Maybe the little guy tried to buck him off, kind of going all different directions. What was this parade like? The other two disciples going to get the baby donkey for Jesus reminds us that often joining the Jesus parade, we're called to do things for Jesus that are pretty mundane, like pretty boring. Following his parade is usually not the stuff we do in front of a crowd. It's not being popular or famous most of the time. Maybe God will place us in a position of influence. But mostly following Jesus' parade is saying, as he did to James and John, fetch me a donkey. It's time for me to make my entrance into Jerusalem as the King of Peace. It's time for my kingdom of loving sacrifice to be launched. We're fulfilling Scripture, and I need a donkey. Do you know, without the donkey, the Palm Sunday parade, it wouldn't have happened in a way that fulfilled Scripture. Jesus wouldn't be recognized as the King who comes in peace, not war. Would be crucified for us. Without the donkey, none of that would have happened. What we do to proclaim Jesus, to prepare the way for Jesus to come, it's just like regular stuff, like you bake a casserole and drop it off to a grieving family. And you say, we love you, and your family's in our prayers. Or you make sure the oil in the church van is changed and the tires are good so the teens can take it out on the youth mission trip. So they can hopefully get some people ready for Jesus to come. I visited this week with one of our couples, and kind of been through a hard time. And she said, you know, she mentioned another couple. They came to our house this winter and shoveled our driveway for us. You shovel snow. Friday, there was another couple at our church loading up bags of food for children we help feed on the weekends through Micah's backpack. Some of you are taking care of kids on Tuesday and Thursday nights, so we can train single moms or moms to be how to follow Jesus. It's not real glorious work, is it? Mundane things. You pray, and nobody knows you're praying. You pray for someone who's struggling. We do these things to lift up Jesus, to prepare for his coming into people's hearts and lives. It's his kingdom work. It's important work. A guy named Will Willimon was serving as the Methodist bishop down in Arkansas. And one Sunday, he was visiting like a district superintendent. He's like a district superintendent. So he was visiting this little Methodist church out in the North Alabama countryside. And after he preached in the service, he got gathered with the pastor and some of the leaders. And Dr. Willimon said, "You know, it's like so easy to preach in your church." He said, the people were all so attentive and responsive, and I saw people taking notes and following along in their Bibles really carefully. And how do you get your people to be so responsive and attentive to the preaching? And he asked the pastor this question in front of the church leaders, and he didn't really know what to say, but there was one of the ladies, she raised her hand. She said, "You know that pulpit you were preaching from?" She said, "My daddy made that pulpit with his own hands. And I remember when I was a little girl," she said, "him bringing those unfinished, rough-cut maple boards into our basement. And I remember the smell of sawdust and varnish coming up every night after my dad got home from work. Heard him sawing and hammering and sanding. Watched him gluing and staining and varnishing until it became that beautiful piece of furniture." The bishop later reminisced that a faithful dad had worked all day and then had gone down into his basement to begin working on that pulpit night after night after night, until finally it was ready to be placed in the front of the church, where preachers like Dr. Willimon could proclaim the message of Jesus. No wonder years later, the people's hearts were open to listen attentively to the message of Jesus. There was that example that was set years ago. Well, most of what we do is pretty mundane, routine. It's like baking pies, studying lessons, saying to people we care about, "I'm praying for you," and actually praying. Taking cookies to the homeless shelter, I don't know, fetching donkeys. So Jesus can come and bring salvation on a cross and show us how to live in his way of sacrificial love. So two Palm Sunday questions, that's it. Are you in the Jesus parade today? Are you following his way? It's not the way of popularity and glamour, power. It's the way of loving service. Are you doing everyday mundane service to Jesus? You fetching some donkeys for him? Just because you love him so much. And you don't care who gets the credit. It's about being obedient every day and serving in a way that honors him. Let's stand together. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Lord, today, thanks for Palm Sunday. It's different this year than it's ever been. No breakfast in the fellowship hall. We miss that. But we're grateful we can be together. We're grateful we can praise your name in this place and in our homes. Thank you that Jesus, in fulfillment of Scripture, chose to begin the last week of his life with the parade. And help us to be among those who are willing to follow Jesus each day. Even when there are struggles and questions and we're sometimes perplexed and we're not sure where we're headed. But Jesus knows. And Jesus goes ahead of us and promises to be with us. And God, just give us, we pray in these days, willing hearts to serve like those two disciples and do what we can to faithfully serve Jesus even when no one notices. Lord, it's such a joy and privilege to know you as our friend and Savior. We ask that this would be a week of drawing closer to you as we follow Jesus to the cross and then celebrate our living Savior together. And we pray in his name, amen.
There's nothing worth more that would ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone, your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory.
let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Amen. Well, before we go today, just a couple quick things. Just a reminder, two services next week. If you have the flexibility, some of you might, you see we're pretty full here at 9:30. Some of you may want to kind of roll over and come to the 11 o'clock service, especially we know that kids will want to come at 9:30 in order to be a part of the Children's Church program. The other suggestion I wanted to make to you, I've been working through the Gospel of Mark, and in Mark chapters 14 and 15, it's the narrative of the passion of Jesus. It's like the last days of Jesus' life. So I'd like to just challenge you this week to spend some time, and they're not real long chapters, but just spend some time quietly reading through those accounts of the end of Jesus' life as part of your personal Holy Week observance. And if you can, join us on Thursday night, either in person or online. Let's pray together, shall we? Heavenly Father, thank you for your presence. Thank you that in uncertain times we lean into the fact that your Spirit is always, always with us in every place, in every circumstance. And so, Lord, our confidence is in your daily quiet presence with us. Lord, we need you. These are times of anxiety, times when some struggle with depression. So Lord, we need your presence. We need your healing grace. We lean into with confidence the knowledge that you're with us. And so, Father, as we go from this place, we follow you. We determine to follow you faithfully as we know how. And with your Spirit, Lord, you're going to help us. And we will join your parade, no matter where it leads us. We choose to follow you. And we go in your power and your presence and pray in the wonderful name of our Savior Jesus. Amen. Amen. You're dismissed. Have a great day. Yeah.